Hi.
Moin. Ja, der
The
Harold
Harold
hat
has some
schon mal
technical
wieder was
issues.
Interessantes
His
programmiert. Deshalb
machine
muss ich
keeps
mich heute selbst herausfordern.
crashing.
Mein
So
Name ist
I'm heralding
Volkorn
myself. My name
und
is
ich bin
Volkorn.
seit einiger Zeit beim Chaos Computer Club
And
dabei und auch unter anderem bei der
work
Mitgliederverwaltung.
a
Und
lot
in
at
dieser
CCC.
Funktion
And one of the things I
habe
work at
ich
is the
mit
member
Professor Junge
desk
gesprochen,
and
weil ne, der
maintaining
Kongress
the
der
data
Chaos Computer Club möchte
register.
natürlich die personenbezogenen Daten seiner
So
Mitglieder
we of
möglichst
course want to
verschlüsselt
communicate with
und
our
wir haben
members
OpenPGP
with
benutzt. Und die
encryption
Mitgliederverwaltung
when
ist
we
bereit.
communicate. And so I want to integrate
Dem sollte heute auch
PGP
einfach darüber,
into
was ich
that
gelernt
system.
habe,
And
darüber reden
today
und
I'm
wie
going to
du
talk
verschlüsselte
about
Mails
how I do that with
mit
Python
Python vernünftig machen
or
kann
not.
oder auch nicht.
Okay.
So. Den Kontext
So
habe ich an
I
dieser Stelle
gave
ja
you
schon
the
kurz
context.
vorweggenommen.
If
Wenn
you
ihr mehr
are
Interesse habt,
interested
darüber zu erfahren,
how
wie die
the
Mitgliederverwaltung
member
des Chaos Computer
management
Clubs neu
actually
war,
is
welche
working
Software wir da benutzen, was die Probleme
and
sind
what
und so
problems
weiter
there
und so
are,
fort, dann schaut
why
einfach
don't
mal auf
you go to
media.cc.de
media
im
CCD
Forum
and
Vollkorn. Da gibt es irgendwie vier Talks und drei
look
davon
for
sind darüber,
vollkorn?
wie
I have a couple of
Mitgliederverwaltung
talks
funktioniert.
about how this
So,
entire system works. Let's start
fangen wir
at the
mal ganz vorne
beginning.
an. Wir haben eine
We
Mitgliederverwaltung, die
have
ist in
a
Python geschrieben.
member management application
Und
written
die
in
ist
Python.
richtig ganz
And
naiv,
as
lalala,
naive as I am, I
einfach
just
schön
was
PGP-Key-Einlegungsfall
want to use
umsetzt zu
something like
nutzen, um
PGP
E-Mails
to
zu
send
verschlüsseln.
encrypted emails.
Also fange ich an, ganz
So
naiv.
I'll start with
Versuch mal,
PIP,
was gibt es
what
denn für Pakete in
Python
PyPI,
packages are
damit
there
die
that
PGP-Key schreiben können?
support PGP?
Und dann gibt es ein paar Ergebnisse und dann guckt man sich
And
die
you get
an
some
und dann
results
kann
and
man
you look at
noch
them.
natürlich ein paar
And
Hürden
some
und
are better than
Dateizeiten.
others, some are
Und das
outdated,
ist üblicherweise, wenn Leute
and
gerade
maybe
alle
there's
dabei sind,
something that
Leute zu
everybody is
benutzen.
using.
Und
Then,
da fing dann schon mein
so at
Stress
that
an, so ein
point, my mood
bisschen zu
got a bit
schlechter
worse.
zu werden. Also, ich nehme euch
So
jetzt mal
I'll
mit auf
take
die
you
Reise der
along on a
Vollkorn, die
short
mir,
tour
die es da alle
on
gibt.
what things there are. Let's start.
Angefangen
Let's
mit
start with
Python,
Python GNU-PG.
von Vinay Sajib, wenn ich das richtig
An
ausspreche, geschrieben. Soweit
author
ich herausfinden konnte, die
that was
erste Python-Bindings, die es gab.
Python
Ist sehr
binding
populär, weil es
that
heute sehr viel
was
benutzt
very
wird.
popular,
Aber
but
das ist
it's
nur
a
ein Standard
really
Wrapper
simple wrapper
über die PGP-Key
around the
Extension.
GPG
Was
executable.
dort intern passiert,
Internally,
ist tatsächlich, dass einfach
it
nur GPG
simply
aufgerufen
runs
wird, ne? Subprocess
GPG
open,
with a
entweder
subprocess
auf
popen.
Windows oder sowas, ne?
Add
Kommandiert
the
ein paar
command line
Parameter
parameters and run
und
it.
aufrufen. Und hier
And
wird dann noch das
I
Subprocess
added the
zugerufen, das
shell
dann
equals true,
alles
because this is one of the
Systemspezifisch
big problems about this.
aufgelegt.
This package
Dieses Paket
has
über
a
viele Schritte
lot
Probleme
of
mit Shell
security
Injection.
issues with
Meistens sind
shell
das die ersten
injections.
Angriffe, aber sowas auch.
I can't really
Manchmal
tell you
benutzen
the
die
exact
Shell-Befehle
patterns, but
Rückbindung in Code, den Kerne, nicht in den Code, in die Daten, in
You
den Kerne
add
der
a
Schlüsselschachtel
couple of interesting
und
things to the
dann
data you want
fortsetzen mit dem
decrypted,
Resten, was
and
ich dann
bingo, it's
kopiere.
executed by GPG.
Naja, aber wie sieht
So,
überhaupt
what
dieses
does
Interface
the
aus?
interface look like?
Executable aufrufen, das ist doch
Is
vermutlich sehr stabil,
the
oder?
calling the
Nicht
command line
anders.
interface is super
Was gibt's
unstable
da an
because
Sachen, die es besser
it
macht,
changes all the
außer
time. So, for
einem wie
example, GPG
gibt mit dem Befehl
Lets you
--with
use the command
--colons, also
list
die unten in der
public
ersten Zeile in der Mitte angegeben ist,
with
an
colons
maschinenlesbares Format
gives
aus. Ich sehe
you
jetzt,
a
das sieht alles sehr groß
machine
aus.
readable
Und
version
diese ganzen
of the data.
Punkte,
And
das
the
sind so die
colons here
Kennzeichen für
are
die
the delimiters between the
verschiedenen
various
Felder, auf
fields,
denen maschinenlesbares
hopefully that you can
aussehen kann.
use
Das große Problem daran ist es natürlich der eigene
in your own
Format.
program.
Man muss das
It's the
lernen,
problem is it's your own
umsetzen,
format, it's a custom format,
schreiben,
you have
einfach
to write
Codes
your
auch
own
verstehen.
parser to read
Das
that data.
ist eher so mäßig
That's
geregelt.
only semi great.
Kleiner Fun-Fact: Natürlich haben sie daran
Fun
gefunden, mit
fact,
dem Doppelpunkt seinen
if you add
Usernamen
a
oder
colon to
seinen
your username
Passwort
or
mit reinschreiben,
for a
dass der
comment,
dann ordentlich
they
escaped
did
wird.
cover that so it's properly escaped.
Das ist ein Backslash X3A. Wenn man ein Backslash X3A reinschreibt, ist auch
And
wieder
if you
sauber,
use the
ne?
escape
Also wenn man
character,
sauber
backslash
encoded ist, dann
X3A,
können die Daten
that
auch
is escaped
aufpassen, dass sie bei der Umwandlung
itself
nicht
again.
kopiert
And so when you read
werden.
that, you have to take that into
Aber
account.
was aber, wenn
But
sich
what
das Format
happens when the
ändert?
format changes? For
Zum Beispiel hat sich
example,
in der GNU-PG-Version
in GNU-PG
2.0.10
version 2.0.10, the format
das Format so
changed
insofern geändert, dass die
that
Timestamps
the
angepasst wurden.
timestamps
Und was
were
passiert
changed.
dann?
So the wrapper completely fails because it cannot read the timestamps and if it doesn't check for this change explicitly. So weird things happen. So this module, so this was the first module that the members' administration worked. There were interesting things in there. So, for example, if a key expired, only an empty return was given, but no exception thrown. And that meant that simply an empty email was sent. And if you have been a member in many years ago, you might have seen exactly that happen. And you might have gotten an empty email, and we get responses. Why did you send me that empty email? So I got a template to reply to those. Hey, the problem is probably that your key has expired. So, very bad detail at this. So this is not a completely empty email. It just looks empty. It has some weird white space characters in it. So you have to strip the white space. You could have dealt with that, and you could have tried to anticipate that problem by checking the key's validity before trying to use it. But that's not a good programming practice. I want that the entire system fails if something goes wrong in the encryption. So there's a new package, GNU-PG, which is kind of an update. No, it's not an update. It's a re-implementation of the implementation. The subprocess invocations were so horrible with security issues and so on. And this is improved. This is not compatible to the old version, to the old package. The API, the Python API, is actually different. But it still has the problem that it is a wrapper that calls the GPG command line tool with an unstable interface. So what else do we have? Let's look into outside of PyPy. Sequoia is its own custom OpenPGP implementation. It's not a wrapper. It's a complete replacement for PGP or GPG. And Sequoia is written in Rust, which is pretty cool. Because Rust helps you avoid many of the common pitfalls like buffer overflows and so on, helps you completely avoid that. And so that's a pretty cool thing. It's pretty performant. There is an attack on PGP keys called signature flooding. Last year, there were two keys of two of the GPG developers were spammed basically by uploading 150,000 keys for each of the two people, and that basically meant that you couldn't use with GPG anymore, and GNU-PG simply didn't work anymore. It slowed down so significantly that you couldn't use it anymore because it was trying to use all these 150,000 keys. So Sequoia managed to do the import of these 150,000 keys in only 5 seconds. So that sounds cool. So let's guess what kind of keys we see in our membership database. So would be very cool to use. What do Python require? Python require bindings, status, early prototype. I looked at it, looks very nice, but there is a lot of stuff missing that we need in our membership management. So let's continue looking. So let's look at the people financing Sequoia, the Pretty Easy Privacy Foundation, and they have their own product called PEP. So they use GPGMe and provides their own Python bindings. But it is open source, but the installation is really hard. To say it like that, I had, you have to multiple dependencies, you have to pre-compile multiple dependencies, there's no ready-made packages for Debian or similar, and finding the instructions on how to actually do this is really hard to find on the website. The link to the instructions gives you 404. So I finally found the repositories, and there's a README, and the README doesn't tell you which brands the most recent branch, and you have to use that other branch. There's cyclic dependencies with, and you have to use the right command invocation to get out of that. And luckily, I was I know one of the developers personally, so I could get around all that. And I finally had the Python bindings ready to go, and it looks very nice. I like the API. There's identities you can create that have keys, and then you can create a message to that identity. And whenever you make a mistake, you immediately get an SE assertion, and the entire Python crashes. And that I don't want. I just want a regular exception. If the Python crashes, I cannot deal with that properly. I need to be able to tell, like, the user, the recipient, oh, your key has expired, and to find out what has happened, I have to restart everything with a debugger, and if I have to send out 20,000 emails, that isn't really practical. So maybe somebody can look into that and improve that software. And so when you start sending that emails with it, this is the MIME message you get. It's an email message that looks empty. I'm not sure why that happens. But so I decided PEP looks very nice, but there are too many issues for me to deal with. So GPGMe, PEP is based on PGP, and those are the official Python bindings of GNU-PG. Let's try that. So how do you do that? You create a project, you create a requirements.txt, and that's where it starts. So which GPGMe do you use? Do you use the one from PyPy? Or pretty much every Linux distribution that includes GPG also includes a package for the Python bindings? Why are they doing that? That's because these Python bindings have to match the version of GNU-PG. Otherwise, it won't work. So the problem is, so you don't want the Python GPG, the Python package from PyPy, but you do want to use the operating system installed package. So you have to somehow manage to pick up the right package from your operating system into your virtual environment. You can do that.
kann man machen.
But
bei mir hat das jetzt
this leads to
einen kleinen
very bad problem because I'm using pipenv. And so I have to give you a short introduction to pipenv. And pipenv is a small tool to create virtual environments in a separate directory, automatically finds it again when you use pipenv commands, and you can directly run commands with pipenv run. And you can check with pipenv if one of the dependencies that you have in your list have any security vulnerabilities, and you can tell pipenv to automatically upgrade them. So that's very good. The only problem with that, pipenv has a bug where quite a number of those versions cannot take over use the command line parameters for system side packages, and that's where pipenv explodes. So with pipenv, you can't use packages outside of virtual environments. So I had to remove pipenv from the equation. The bug is fixed, and eventually there will be a version of pipenv that can deal with the problem, but it takes all a very long time. So encrypting things is one thing, but I also want to download keys. So in the member management, we only use a key ID that you can add to a user's record. And the membership application actually has a field for the key ID. And we use the classic key servers to search for the key, download it, and use that. And that was wonderful, working well, until Hagrid happened. Hagrid is a key server based on Sequoia, developed in Rust, deals very well with the signature flooding problem, and can survive the signature spamming. And it does quite a few things very nicely. For example, if you look at the classic key servers, they built in a way that you can only add data. So if somebody gives me their key, and I upload their key, and it's being added to the server, and nobody can remove it. So the owner of the key, the only thing they can do is revoke the key, but they cannot remove it from the key server, and the email address is publicly available on the key server forever. So Hagrid introduced a way where keys are only added if you confirm by email that you actually want your key added to the server. Additionally, you have to say that the classic key servers are written in a very obscure Occam dialect, and the software behind it is a very clever algorithm to synchronize the key servers between the various instances, a PhD thesis program, but really hard to maintain because very few people can read the cane, can read the code, and very few people actually can provide improvements. And Hagrid, of course, is well a lot better suited to this situation because of using Rust and so on. And so all the tools are eventually switching over to the new server. So you can see here all the new machines and the new packages all switched over as a default server to the new one. So the problem is that we have a lot of people who are using the old key servers, and new people are using the new key servers and don't even know that there is a different world with the old key servers.
OpenPGP. So, so you have to explain to them, why don't you upload your key to the old one, and they don't want that because they don't get the confirmation, and so there's a lot of trouble trying to get that working. And so the easy solution here is we just try to find the key on both the new and the old instances. So that's not easy to do in PGP because there's a single config file and you can add a number of key servers. In GPG only use one of them, even if you have configured multiple servers. So if you want to query multiple key servers, you have to edit the config file for the agent and GPG, and so you have to edit that, and then so whenever you want to look up a new key, you have to repeat editing the file and querying the key, and that's not something you want to do for 2,000 mails. And especially not in parallel, that won't work. So, not very nice. We're not the only ones having these problems. So, for example, this HKP4PI is HKP is the name of the protocol that is used to query keys from the servers. And the small module, Python module, can talk directly to the key servers and download the key server from the keys from the key servers. HTTP based protocol, and it's very simple. Ask these servers and ask download the list of this list of keys. And then you can import them directly into GPG. So everything is fine. But I fell flat on my nose there because my GPG bindings doesn't have a key import function. I like stable software. I have an old version of Ubuntu. And 18.04 is only 2 years old, but is completely out of date from the viewpoint of GPG. And the import version, the import function, is has only been available for less than 2 years. So another thing where we go back to the beginning, do I want to upgrade my GPG? Is it really easier? So in July is probably the time when you should switch LTS releases. So then you can think about, oh, why don't I do a source install of GPG? Very simple. It's only about 30 steps. So I wanted to keep it simple and not too many complex steps and keep it simple. GPG.me, if you do it right, you can do it. You can encrypt your emails, but there's a lot of stumbling stones, pitfalls that you have to get around. You can do that. You can download the keys. You can decrypt emails. So and handle the private key. So let's continue looking. So we don't just want encrypted contents. We want the email to actually go out as a PGP MIME message. In the old standard, PGP PGP GPG would simply attach the encrypted message as an attachment, but the new MIME format is much better because email clients can work with that a lot more nicely. So there's a lot of modules that you can use on PyPI. PGP MIME is one of them you find quickly. So if I understood correctly, looking around at the documentation and the source code, the ASLAN protocol is what the GPG-Me bindings use to talk to GPG. The problem is, so they managed to remove many of the subprocess calls, but for some it is still necessary. And the last commit was in 2012, and it's like one student who did that, and nothing has happened since. So email GPG, a very thin layer that simply builds up my messages and doesn't really do any of the GPG bindings. So I can't remember the name who did this. RiseUp, I think. I think the people behind RiseUp put this together. It was created once, 2018. There is no documentation. And if you look at the source code, in the standard configuration, it doesn't do anything with encryption. And the only thing, everything you need to do is replace the NOAP codec with the proper codec. I think it could work well, but I haven't tried that yet. It's on my to-do list for one of the next times I look at this. Then there's GPG mail encrypt. It's the kitchen sink. It does everything. It uses subprocess calls. It integrates virus scans and spam protection and has its own mail server built in. And the idea is that this is a gateway before your real mail server to do everything. So way too much for my purposes. So GPG MIME uses Python GnuPG, the very old module that has all these problems, and I don't actually want to use that. So CryptoMime, the same, basically. GPG LibLib. It becomes interesting here. It can use Python GnuPG or GPG-Me. And GPG-Me is the name that the official Python bindings for GPG had. It was renamed at the very last minute. And they haven't followed the renaming, and the last commit is 2017, and it doesn't look like it would work together with the current GPG. At that point, I decided that's not something I will look into in detail. So finally, I think I'll just build it myself. MIME is not that hard. There's the email MIME package from the standard library, and MIME, creating a MIME email. Let's look at how PGP MIME is actually put together. You have a multi-part mixed message, the container. So the very first line defines that, and the very last line ends it. And in between, there is a multi-part alternative. So with text plain and text HTML, so you can send out different variants of the email and can put in an explanation for people who can only read the plain text. And then there is an attachment, and we can add multiple attachments. And this will always be shown because it's not in the alternative block. If somebody gets an email with Apple Mail, and we have to look at the plain text, and since the attachment is part of the HTML part, it will not be shown. So all of this is encrypted with OpenPGP. And then add that to another MIME mail container that looks like this. So you can see from begin PGP message to end PGP mission, which is put into a multi-part encrypted container. So far, so good. That's what you need to do. You have to use GPG. You have to pick the version of GPG, somehow get Python bindings up and running, and then package it all up in MIME. And at the end, I recommend that if you do all of that, you should set up, you have a test setup where you basically create encrypted emails into an EML file, which you can open, for example, with Thunderbird. So to summarize, take the Python bindings from GnuPG version 2.0.12 or newer, the official bindings. Use the Python bindings delivered by your operating system, so it matches the GPG binary. Use HKP 4 Pi for the key server communication, and then somehow build some MIME around it. This can be really hard. It's really helpful to reread how PGP MIME is actually to be implemented. So reading the RFC is really helpful. Really great ecosystem. It's a lot of fun to work with it. And now I'm ready for your questions.